Good morning and welcome. Do you know what I love about here? See, the last 2 minutes, everybody comes.
It is brilliant.
Everybody is welcome on time or slightly over time. Okay, firstly, thank you to everybody who's dressed as if it is July. I see a couple of summer shirts coming in there. Thank you for wearing them. Can I just say a big thank you to Rhoda and the team yesterday. We had a funeral here yesterday. It was the first time that we've had tea at a funeral, but it's also the first time that we've had tea at a funeral when we use the hall for the service. So they've done brilliant. And they were here from 11, and I think they left about 4-ish. So thank you for that. That is a ministry. I really appreciate it. Can I also just say there's a vestry meeting on Tuesday night at 8 o'clock. And at that vestry meeting, hopefully you're getting 99% of the information. We're still waiting on a tiny piece of the jigsaw. But we want to have the vestry meeting, update the vestry, and then as soon as we get that last wee bit of the jigsaw, we're going to have the kind of everybody come to the hall for an update. And again, I hope you noticed the lovely sign at the top of the road. The tractor run is on the 29th of this month, the last Friday of this month. So looking forward to that. And just keep that in your prayers. That's a fundraiser for James. Okay, that's all the announcements. Great. That's the lovely thing about the summer. I'm going to ask David to come up here. David, do you want to stand here? That mic? That's perfect. Thank you. I want David to be up here because is there a photograph of him? Here, some good-looking people up there. You take a wee moment, don't you, just to say where is it? So there he is. That was Wednesday night, and a number of people, about 20 of us, went to down cathedral. It was a gorgeous night. So the setting was lovely. But David, just before we get going, you just don't wrap up and go to these things and they give you a wee piece of paper, which is your license. You want to tell us just how that you're studying and the kind of the journey up to that?
Absolutely. I suppose it's a journey that's taken a number of years to get to this point. And Mrs. Crutchley, whoever she is, will remember, I would say back in maybe 2009, she handed me an application form. And she says, David, I would love you to consider lay ministry. And I sort of looked at her, I says, surely no, I don't know if that's for me. She says, no, pray about that. So that was okay. And I put it in the cupboard and thought nothing more of it. And a number of years later, I came across that application form again. And I just said, that's good to see that. I remember Mrs. Crutchley telling me about that, and I'll put that away again. And I did put it away. And there was one night I was speaking in church, and Mrs. Crutchley came to me at the back of the church, and she says, David, I don't want to alarm you, but the bishop has just pulled into the car park. I says, Shirley, don't be thick. Like, I am preaching tonight, and like, I don't really need you to be telling me that. And lo and behold, who walks through the door but the bishop? And after the service, he came over to me, and he says, David, the Church of Ireland needs men and women who teach the word faithfully. And I want you to consider going on for some type of ministry. So between Shirley at me for years and the bishop at me as well, Lindsay and I really started to consider this very prayerfully. And I applied, I suppose, a couple of years ago, went through an interview process, went through a year of all I did was read books and do sermons, far from sermons, essays, that's the word, academically based essays down for Trinity College in Dublin. And alongside that, did different courses within the diocese. And then had another interview with the bishop following that, and then got commissioned on Wednesday night. So it was a journey.
A journey in the making.
You know, a journey in the making.
David, as I listen to you speaking, the learning outcome for me from that is, if you see Shirley Cussley coming to you with a piece of paper and run. That's good. That's good. But it was lovely to be there and to see all that happening. And so you will see David appearing at different stages and in different services. I'm absolutely delighted. But David's going to lead today. But before you lead us, David, I just want to pray. Dear God, I do thank you for moments like this when we're reminded that we are in this together. There isn't one person. There is a team of people. And every single person is part of that team. And Lord, I do thank you for the different people. Yesterday we've seen ministry being given in sandwiches and cups of tea. And Lord, ministry happens in so many different ways. And Lord, I do thank you for the skill set here within Kilmore. Lord, I do commit David to you. And we're thankful for having him here with us. And they will commit him and his family to you. Lord, may they know your protection. May they know your blessing. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Folks, I just wanted to share one other wee thing before we get started. And God has been very faithful throughout all of this. And we talk about God at work, and we talk about God being in complete control. And sometimes we can say that very loosely. And I remember whenever I was going through the period of studying, there was a time where we had three assignments to be done over the summer months. And I said, and in my own head, I said, you know, I would love these to be done by the end of June so that we have the summer off. We don't need to worry about it. And I had them done by the end of June. And it's by God's grace that those were done, because at the end of July, my father passed away. And I would have been in no fit state to do assignments. And God was so faithful in leading me down to what I thought was my plan of, let's get this done by the end of June so that I can have the summer off. But God's plan was, let's get this done by the end of June because I know what you're going to be going through beyond that. And I just think that's so, so powerful. And I just wanted to thank a couple of people specifically. Just to Lindsay and the girls for, you know, being with me throughout all of this. The number of nights I've been out studying outside and my man shed, as it's called, you know, was colossal. And also to the wider church family and friends, and especially to Mrs. Crutchley. You know, she has been absolutely amazing, such an encouragement. She has been through this before, and she has done this many, many years ago, and she was such an encouragement. And a massive thank you to our Select Vestry. Our Select Vestry, for any, like, I know we hear about the Select Vestry, but the Select Vestry's primary focus is all about mission. I know they talk about fabric, finances, and furnishings, but mission is the primary function of that vestry. And I just want to thank you for all of that. And I just want to thank Jeff as well. Jeff has been just such an encouragement. I would have been sitting studying and just said, I couldn't be bothered with this anymore. And all of a sudden getting a text, you know, a wee text, and, you know, something of encouragement, you know, a thumbs up or a keep or lip or whatever it is. And it just comes at the right time. So just thank you for everything that everybody has done to support me through this. And we're going to start off with our collect this morning. Almighty God, you have broken the tyranny of sin and have sent the Spirit of your Son into our hearts, whereby we call you Father. Give us grace to dedicate our freedom to your service, that we and all creation may be brought to the glorious liberty of the children of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And a sentence of scripture from Philippians 2 verse 4, let each of us look not only to our own interests, but also to the interests of others. And our opening hymn this morning is Go Forth and Tell. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And together we join in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And we stand together to sing our second hymn, Lord of the Living Harvest.
After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into this harvest. Go your way. Behold, I am sending you out as lambs in the midst of wolves. Carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace be to this house.' And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you. And remain in the same house, eating and drinking what they provide. For the labourer deserves his wages. Do not go from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and they receive you, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick in it and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not receive you, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off against you.' Nevertheless, know this, that the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Matthew, thank you. Now, I'm just, see the way you are at the very front here, you are in danger. You have just left school, and I reckon your brains have already just, you know what I mean, went on holiday. No, I'll be right. You're going to prove it. You need to, can you put your fingers up? You're going to do a brain exercise. You ready? Now you've got to get exactly exercises. Oh, not bad. I'll give you 55 out of 100. Right, it is the summer. I know some people here have already been on holiday, and some people have still to go on holiday. Do you remember years ago when the build-up to a holiday was actually a big part of it, and you looked forward to going? I now know there's moms and dads thinking, will that plane be on? It's just all changed. But anyway, here we are. So, what I'm going to give you some questions, right? Now, here's the deal. You're going away for a week because David is in such good form after Wednesday night that he's setting the whole of Kilhorn anywhere they want for a week on his slate. It's great. So, you're going for a week's holiday. Now, it's all inclusive, so you've no money. But you'll get your food, and you can have drinks, and maybe a wee lollipop now and again. But you've no money for this week, so you've got to make decisions. You are going to pack your bag, and here's your choices. Are you going to take in your suitcase a first aid kit or a soap bag? You know, it kind of has a deodorant and all that stuff in it. What are you going for?
First aid kit.
First aid kit? Oh! Now, you got the smelly, but if anything goes wrong, you're the person to go. That's fair. Now, I want you to imagine you mightn't have to take tablets and medication, but imagine you did. Are you going to take medication with you, or are you going to take sweets?
Medication.
Oh, that's very strong. Good. Anybody for sweets? No. That's right. Okay. If you get the choice of these, would you take an iPhone or would you take an iPad?
iPhone.
Oh, okay. Now, if you're going to fly to a different country, would you take a passport or a newspaper?
Passport.
Easy. Now, here we go. You ready for this one? If it's a sunny place you're going to, are you going to take sunglasses or sun cream?
Sun cream.
I
think you can write that.
Okay. Now, don't rush into this one. This is a difficult one. Are you going to take a clean pair of socks or a clean pair of pants? You've got to make a choice here. Okay, that's everybody, you know. Now, what about this one? You're either going to have chips with every meal, breakfast, lunch, and your tea, or no chips at all.
Chips.
Oh, chips into your breakfast. That's good. I'll have to call around your house tonight. Now, trainers or flip-flops?
Trainers.
Right. Okay. Now, jeans, trousers, whatever you're into, or shorts?
Shorts.
And what happens if you want to put a brush? You're running around about shorts, freezing. That's all you need to put. Here's the last one, right? Now remember, you've no money to buy anything. Are you taking a toothbrush or are you taking toothpaste?
Toothpaste.
Okay, well, you just use your finger. Okay, perfect. Now, you're probably thinking, that's a bit random, they're strange. Do you remember that reading that Matthew has just read for us? Jesus called his team together, 72 of them, and he was sending them out two by two. But in that Bible reading, Jesus told them, I want you to go. Don't be taking any money. Don't be taking sandals. And he told them certain things that you would normally take, and he told them not to take them. And I find that really interesting. When you are doing your wee church, we're going to be looking at that story. But when you really look at it, here's the thing. Jesus was sending them out, and they had to depend 100% on him. That all the things they needed would happen. And I love that, because sometimes we, the youngest in here, right up to the oldest, we need to be reminded that we actually depend on God for everything. So keep that really close in your heart. And just let that mull over in your head this week. What does it look like for you and for me to depend on God? Amen.
Kind of Jeff to say that I was treating everybody for a holiday. I left my card with Wendy. I don't know if we're not going to go with that. Okay, we're going to have our third hymn. After this, the children can leave for children's church. And our third hymn is, "You give the great commission, heal the sick and preach the word."
Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, We believe in God the Son, who died for our sins and rose again for our justification. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
And just take your seats. And Jeff, just before Jeff comes to minister to us from God's word, let's just pray as Jeff comes to us. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for being able to hear your word being faithfully taught. Father, we just ask, Lord, that you are with us as we hear, as we listen, and as we try to apply all that it is that you want us to take away from this passage this morning. Be with Jeff, Lord, as he teaches us from your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 I'll take all the prayer. Thank you. Okay, what I want to do, that wee passage of scripture, is just to walk through it and just to see where we'll go to. So here is verse 1. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go to. Verse 1 of chapter 10 starts with two words, after this. So right away I'm thinking, right, after this, let's check out what that means. After what? Last Sunday we concluded with Luke 9, verse 62, as Jesus declared that no one who puts a hand to the plough and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Now the truth is, we probably in today's world wouldn't be so full on. Like that's, there's no messing about there. There's no middle ground. Your hand to the plough, or you don't have it to the plough. Last week, we also looked at some of the would-be followers and their understanding of discipleship, of what it meant to follow Jesus. So today, we're starting off as Jesus is sending this team out. And like, just think about that. You know, 72 of them, wee bit of buzz. I don't know how it all worked. Did they all have a big massive team meeting? Did they meet for a couple of days? But we know they're now being sent out. Here's verse 2. Jesus told them, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. It's not exactly one of these big rallying calls. You're basically being told out, there's only few of you who are going out to do the work that has to happen. So you're being reminded here that you prefer a bit of responsibility. Jesus' metaphor of his mission as a harvest sets the tone for what's about to unfold. Jesus' answer to the problem of a greater harvest and few labourers is prayer. The first thing isn't a strategic planning meeting or a needs analysis. Interesting, isn't it? Because we've a wee tendency, and that's how we might approach it today. We need to have a meeting about a meeting. And yet Jesus' response is, pray. So the first step is prayer. And I have to admit, I never want to compare everything to our situation in the rebuild, but actually, we started off this whole project, with that wee kind of, that nice image that Lydia done for us, will the prayer on the back of it. Can I ask you to keep on praying? Because we're moving from stage 1 to stage 2, and there will be some big numbers coming down the line. Let's keep praying, and let's keep committing this project to God, because it's much bigger than us. But that's brilliant. Do you want to know why? Because you need to be dependent on God. You can do more than pray. You can do more than pray after you have prayed, but you cannot do more than pray until you have prayed. I'll read that again. You can do more than pray after you have prayed, but you cannot do more than pray until you have prayed. Here's a Tozer quote. The creeping wilderness will soon take over that church trusts in its own strength and forgets to watch and pray. May that never be the story here in Kilhorn. May we never think here, we're a wee bit better than that church up the road. May we never fall into the trap of thinking our good ideas and our best suggestions, you know what I mean, is all that we require. May we continue to be dependent. I always find the words of D.L. Moody challenging. Every great movement of God can be traced to a kneeling figure. Every great movement of God can be traced to a kneeling figure. Generally speaking, they're never trendy. Generally speaking, they're unseen people and nobody really knows about them. The challenge is, who are the unseen praying people in Kilharn? Can I thank you? Can I affirm you? And please continue to pray, because it's more than necessary. We need to be desperate. Verse 3 and 4. Now, when you hear this, I really don't want to be here when I'm hearing this kind of commission. Funny, speaking about commission, David was commissioned on Wednesday night. When you hear this commission for Lee 72, and this is Jesus speaking, go. I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. It's just not the line you want to hear. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. Notice that Jesus doesn't say that they need to pray and hope something happens. They are to pray and then go. The theory has to become practice. Going takes a bit of a nerve at the best of times. If I say, right, let's all meet up here tomorrow and at 8 o'clock we're all going to do that Saw Hill estate on the way in here. We're going to rock doors. You'd be coming up here a wee bit nervous. But Jesus really raises the bar when he sends them out like lambs among wolves. You don't get a more intense description than that. Just when you think it can't get any worse, they're told not to bring money, not to bring belongings, and not to bring sandals. It just blows my mind. Why? Jesus was teaching them a lesson on complete dependence. I tell you, I do believe we're being taught a similar lesson, you know, with our situation. I read this week. True humility means total dependence on God. You can only be truly dependent on God if you're humble. And I'll tell you, being humble isn't all trend these days. As pride is independence of God, humility is dependence on God. So I want you to imagine yourself, you're one of the 72, when you would have, what would have been most challenging for you? So we kind of messed about a wee bit with the children. We're going to mess about with you now. Would you have found it really challenging going with no money? Or would you have found it even more challenging not having an extra set of clothes? There's bound to be one or two people in here who have been slightly freaked out because you didn't like the whole idea of not having accommodation pre-booked. You know, I love it when you get a couple and they're going on holiday and one just wants to go free and the other one wants the whole thing pre-booked. Or would you have really struggled if you had to depend on other people for food? Well, you couldn't rock up your car, you know what I mean, and get what you want. Or would it really have pushed you to the line if you basically had to eat what was set in front of you? Because that was one of the stipulations. Whatever you're given, just get over yourself and eat it. Rather than equipping the disciples, it's as if Jesus de-equips the disciples. The absence of basic traveling equipment indicates a total dependence of the disciples on the sender. The instruction to greet no one along the way highlights the urgency of their mission. It's not about being offensive. It's not about being ignorant. Jesus is making the point, this mission needs to happen. Get on with it. Don't be hanging about. You've been given your task. Verse 5, when you enter a house, first say, peace to this house. Now, we're moving here into, we miss that because we haven't grown up in that Jewish tradition. They are to announce peace to a household, a greeting that in a Jewish context expresses well-being and restoration. This is not just a word. The word shalom in Hebrew, this is what it speaks about. Luke often defines peace in terms of God's arriving salvation. What does this peace look like here in Kilhorn? What shape does this peace take in our lives? It is not a peace that you retain in the sense of it's mine, nobody's getting it. It's a peace you're meant to share, firstly, with the people you live with, and secondly, to those you encounter. That's a big challenge. Maybe we have an understanding of peace as too small or too narrow. I think we do have. This peace is about loving our neighbour as ourselves. This peace is about loving our enemies and doing to others as we would have them do to us. This peace means being merciful rather than judgmental. This peace means addressing the log in your own eye rather than the speck in somebody else's. This peace offers forgiveness not 7 times, but 70 times 7. This peace means feeding the hungry, visiting the sick and the imprisoned. This peace means choosing not to become or to act like a wolf when we stand in the midst of wolves. I'll tell you now, this peace is heavy duty stuff. Offering the peace of Christ is so much more than a handshake. Because in the Church of Ireland, pre-COVID, that's what we used to do. You would offer the peace and it was a handshake. People, it's not a handshake, it's a way of life. Maybe, and maybe just maybe think for a moment of the baggage we carry, the stuff that trips us up, and the stuff that keeps us imprisoned. Maybe it's a baggage from our past. It might be fear. Fear from something that happened 25 years ago, but it may as well have happened yesterday because it's got you kind of in a corner. It might be a wound or a grudge, or it actually might be the need in somebody here that you really feel you need to be better than somebody else. You gotta let that stuff go because it only messes you up. What baggage do we need to leave behind today if we're going to fully embody God's peace? All of us are messed up. You know what I mean? I can bluff about you better than most people, but we're all messed up. We all carry stuff. And God wants us to let it go. Verses 6 and 7. If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking, whatever they give you. For the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. Interesting, that whole idea. These people could have ended up going to a house, and it might have been a house who gave them a welcome. But actually, it wasn't the top house in the village. It wasn't my house in the village. It could have been a house where there maybe a smaller house, there maybe wasn't as much food. We've got the big house, but you could call any night, there might be a whole lot of eat. So the whole idea was that you be content, that you be thankful for what you have. Jesus' instructions were essentially that they should expect and depend on the hospitality of the people to whom they were being sent. Again, this was a very ordinary Jewish way of life. It was expected that travellers would be offered hospitality, and to refuse to do so was really, really offensive in that culture. Basically, Jesus was telling his disciples to be thankful guests, because in this way, their message would be more easily received. Here's a challenge for you and me today, and it's thankfulness. I don't see that on TV. That's not being pumped into my head. There's a load of other stuff being pumped into my head. Thankfulness turns what we have into enough and more. It turns denial into acceptance, chaos to order, confusion to clarity. Thankfulness can turn a meal into a feast, a house into a home, a stranger into a friend. We don't need more to be thankful for. We just need to be more thankful. Wow, different way to live your life when you fully understand that what you have is God's gift to you, and to live it and share it to the best of your ability. Verses 8 and 9. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal those who are there who are ill, and tell them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. If welcomed, they're instructed to heal and to announce the arriving of God's kingdom. Just to, when you do the sermon training in Dublin, you talk about the coming into land, or coming into land here. Verses 10 and 11. But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you. Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near. Again, we hear that living in Analog and we miss it a wee bit. In the Jewish context, if rejected, they are to wipe the dust off their feet. A reference to the Jewish practice of removing the dust of foreign soil when returning to Israel. That was a big deal. When people seen that happening, when this happened with these 72, people got it. People knew this was serious. They knew a line had been crossed. They knew they were staying this side of the line, even though they were invited to go to this side of the line. Finally, I just want to read that Matthew didn't read these because it wasn't a set reading, but I do want to read the last couple of verses, 17 to 20, because it's interesting to see the 72 coming back, and here it is. The 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. But Jesus replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. However, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. I read that. And if you've been to 72, if you've seen big stuff happening, if you've seen people healed, if you've seen demons cast out, let me tell you now, you're returning top form. You are bursting, and yet Jesus calms them down. Jesus listened to their experience of power, but he redirects their joy, reminding them to be grounded, not in what they've been empowered to do, but in God's faithful saving action as their names are written in heaven. Just to conclude, what are we made for? To know God. What aim should we have in life? To know God. What's the eternal life that Jesus gives? To know God. What's the best thing in life? To know God. Finally, let's embrace the fact that we are and always will be wholly dependent on God for everything. Here's your call. Is that a weakness or is that a strength? Amen.
I'd like to invite Samuel up to lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning as a body of believers to worship and praise you. We thank you for all what you've done in and through your Son, Jesus Christ. As we have been focusing on how Jesus sent out his followers to serve him while he was on earth, we reflect on how we can magnify and glorify your name in our daily lives. Lord, be with you, be with us now by your Spirit. Teach us and encourage us by your word daily to carry out your great commission. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord, we thank you and praise you for this present day. Help us to live thankful lives and to be able to count our blessings. We give thanks for the summer months ahead, for time to rest and relax. Remind us of those words you said to your disciples, come away and rest. Help us to draw near to you in our times of rest and make us realize that we do not worship a schedule, but we worship a Savior. We thank you for visitors coming to Kilmore during the summer months, both new and returning. We pray that they will feel part of the church community and church family as we come to worship God and hear his word preached and proclaimed. We pray your blessing upon Kilhorn, that everyone who comes to our service will be encouraged and strengthened in the faith, and that ultimately lost souls would be won for Christ in the preaching of the good news of the gospel. Amen. We pray that you would be with our young people in Kilhorn that have just finished school or university exams. We thank you for time to relax and enjoy being with friends and family away from the pressures of exams and term time work. We also pray for those young people in our church who will be involved in Christian outreach throughout the summer in association with Crosslinks, BCM and CEF, that they would grow in faith and love for you and they would serve you in an evangelistic way. Amen. We pray for families with children off school for the summer. For many parents, this can be a time of stress as they juggle work, childcare, and extra expenses, which can be hard for some families to afford. So we pray for the families in our church, our wider community, and broadly we pray for families and households across the UK who are struggling with living costs. We pray for parents who have to go without meals in order to feed their children, and for those living in a state of anxiety, worrying about how they will pay their bills. Help us as to be willing to help families who are going through such times that we can help them through our prayers and our deeds, and that all that will be done for your glory. Amen. Our Bible reading and sermon this morning has helped us to remember that your presence brings peace. So we pray for our world and our prayers turn to countries that are in conflict. And the war in Ukraine and other countries such as Afghanistan, Syria, and Yemen that are in war. We pray for people whose lives are lived in the backdrop of war, violence, and conflict. For those whose families have been torn apart and fractured by the act of war. Those who find themselves without homes or without family. For those who live in fear each day of more attacks, more bombs, and more violence. For those who have died in the cause of war and the families that they've left behind, for the lives they need to be remade, recovered, and resolved. Have grace and mercy upon these people, that they may find eternal hope and comfort in the merit of your Son. Amen. We pray for those who are ill and housebound in Kilhorn. We pray for families who have recently been bereaved. And we pray especially for Linda and the death of her mother, Eleanor. For Linda's husband, Keith, their children and grandchildren, and the wider family circle. Lord, we pray that your peace and comfort would be their portion in this time of suffering and grieving. Amen. We conclude all our prayers together, saying the words of the grace.
And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen.
Our final hymn this morning is "We Have a Gospel to Proclaim." just a massive thank you for everybody being here this morning. Just everybody take a wee seat as well. You know, I was talking to a fellow earlier this week, and I said, you know, you get a real sense of family and community here in Kilhorn, and it's true that you do, especially whenever you see all that takes place to make the service work. So, like, thank you to Valerie in the choir, to Davy and Ronald at the back, to the ladies doing the tea in there, and Olivia smiling at me through the window, and, you know, to the creche, the children's church, Samuel for the prayers, Matthew for the reading, Jeff preaching, and anybody else that has been involved to make this work this morning. Thank you. And our concluding prayer: Eternal God and Father, by whose power we are created and by whose love we are redeemed, guide and strengthen us here in Kilhorn by your Spirit, that we may give ourselves to your service and live in love to one another and to you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and Lord. Amen. And don't rush off. There's a cup of tea for anybody that wants to stay. If you're a visitor here, you're especially welcome to stay for a cup of tea. And this evening at 6 o'clock, we celebrate the Lord's Supper. So we'll hope to see you back at 6 this evening. Thank you.